Hi Spring fans! Welcome to another installment of Spring Tips. In this installment, we're going to look at a brand new project that we've just recently announced called Spring Foo. Now, Spring Foo is, as it says on the tin, a Kotlin micro framework that makes it easy to create lightweight Spring-powered applications with functional APIs instead of annotations. It's important to emphasize that this is a Kotlin-first API. There is no real Java support here. And the goal is to make it so that you can write applications without using annotations, and instead to prefer functional approaches to building, to configuring applications. And so this is a new project. This is not related to Spring Boot. It's just another way to compose APIs in the Spring ecosystem using their programmatic or functional APIs, right? This does not use annotation by default. It doesn't use any of the things. It doesn't have auto configuration. It doesn't have any of that. And it doesn't even have this, you know, in most things you'll find in Spring Foo are explicit as opposed to implicit. But the result is that you get this very, very lightweight footprint. And this footprint, by the way, we'll come back to that in a little bit, but the footprint we hope to make even smaller, right? We want to be able to get to the point where you're doing almost no reflection, runtime reflection, or minimal runtime reflection. And as such, we can do things like static analysis using tools like the Growl native image builder. Growl, of course, being it's a JVM written inside of Java, right? It's a JVM written using the JVM that supports running Java applications, and that can do some really amazing things. You can actually build a native image based on the understanding of what the classes that the application will use at runtime are, and that just basically boots up instantly, right? You have this really, really fast access Growl image, for example. So there's a lot of options, a lot of possibilities once we move to code that reduces reflection and is very explicit about what we're doing here. And this is not meant to be a destination for existing applications from yesteryear. This is a micro framework. It's supposed to support a very small, very fixed set of use cases, but it does so in a very, very nice way. And it does so using Kotlin DSLs and APIs. These are Kotlin first DSLs. We're using a lot of APIs from Spring, but we're exposing them through DSLs in Kotlin, first of all. And then second of all, these functional APIs, as they don't require annotations, I hope one day will be candidates for use in other languages that don't support the Java concept of annotations, like, for example, JavaScript, right? Or Clojure, which is a Lisp variant on the JVM, right? So a lot of different options here, but for now we start with Kotlin. So let's go ahead and build a new application using, what else, a Kotlin-based Gradle file. So I'm going to go ahead and create a new demo here, make dear reservation hyphen service source main Kotlin demo resources. All right, so I'm going to create a directory structure there, and again, you know, would that I could, but this doesn't have a Spring initializer sort of bootstrap thing, so we're just doing it by hand. But as you'll see, at this point, it's not such a big deal, right? So I'm going to copy and paste my existing Gradle file here, though, because that is something with which I'm not super familiar. So move build.gradle to reservation service, cd reservation service. There we are. So there's my my new project. I'm going to open this up in my IDE. So here we are. Now, of course, I'm using Gradle. Gradle traditionally is a build file that uses Groovy for its DSL, but the root sort of API in Gradle was written in Java, and there's no reason you couldn't expose it to other languages. And so a year or two ago, the Gradle team did just that. They created a DSL for Kotlin. And so really, this is a full stack application here. That's one of the nice things about Kotlin, is that there are Kotlin compilers. You can use Kotlin to target JavaScript, like actual, you know, JavaScript that runs in the browser. You can use Kotlin to target native code using Kotlin Native, and you can use Kotlin to target the JVM. And so the result is that you can write your build in Gradle. You can then write your application using your server-side, you know, backend application using Spring and Kotlin. You can use your Kotlin file, your Kotlin Gradle file, your Kotlin backend application in Spring, and then you can write a front-end web application using React and use Kotlin for that. And then if you wanted to, you could write something that talks to your file system or to your operating system or uses Linux, native APIs or whatever, does something interesting in that respect using Kotlin Native as well. So You could really do full stack. This is one unique opportunity here that we haven't had in a while. Historically, when people say full stack, they mean, just the back end, the front end, and the servers, the persistence and the view. All of that was running on the server side, so they would say that was a full stack. But I think what we're really talking about now is every tier of the application of a distributed system, and that's all now Kotlin. All right, so we have now our application. Let's see here. Let me refresh this. For some reason, IntelliJ seems to synchronize my old examples here. Very good. So there we are. I'm going to create a new file here. Let me hit @enable auto import. And we'll create a new Kotlin application. Call it a class. Very good. And this will be our entry point into the application. And when we build the application, we are pointing the build to our application entry point, our demo application KT. Now, our if you look at the reference, the logical reference to our class, into this code file, it would be demo.application. But in terms of what the compiler is going to output, you're going to get a class literal that is application.kt.class. And that's the Kotlin compiler creating a thing that, then gets targeted into the JVM. So what we have to tell our build is use demo.application.kt. This will create a so-called fat jar, and that gets done for us. You can see it's a little tedious. I have to manage a few things. There's some plugins. There's the Kotlin compiler plugin, the Spring IO dependency management plugin. There's the Shadow plugin, which is creating the fat jar, the configuration of the application itself. That's this bit right here. And of course, all the dependencies that we care about. So logging support, Jackson, MongoDB, Mustache views, and the reactive Webflux, Spring Webflux, Netty-based API, the component model for building HTTP endpoints. And we have the different repositories that we care about. Now, in my example, today, right now, early part of June, I guess the first third of June 2018, in my example, I had to compile all this. I had to compile Spring Foo. I just did Gradle install dist into in the root of the Spring Foo project from GitHub, and then I was able to use those dependencies in this application. But eventually, soon, they'll be in the Spring snapshots libraries and the librelease libraries. And eventually, of course, hopefully, this will be GA. So you won't have to have any of this. But for now, since we're using super cutting edge stuff, it's nice to have that there. Now, keep in mind, this is all, like I say, very, very cutting edge stuff. We're using Spring Boot dependencies, 2.02, but we're overriding the Spring.dev version. We're using Spring Framework 5.1 build snapshots, which hasn't been released. We're using the latest and greatest version of Reactor, right? The build snapshot for California. So, a lot of useful stuff there, but you won't have to do this for long. Again, this is cutting edge. This is all brand new. So this is now the chance to kick the tires and try it out. And if you have things you want to feedback, please do, right? Now, with that, let's go ahead and build our application. Okay. And build our application. And our application is going to have a main method or a main function. And remember, in Kotlin, there are member functions and top-level functions, right? But they're just functions all the way around. So I'm going to say array of string. And there's that. That's the entry point. Now, in this case, my entry point, as long as it returns unit, then who cares how it gets at unit. And what we're going to do is we're going to create an application. So val app equals, and we're going to use the DSL here for our Spring Foo DSL for creating an application. And we can say app.run. And I'm going to say await equals true. And that's it. That's a simple Spring Foo application. Couldn't get simpler, right? So here we're creating an application, which ultimately creates an application context and all that, and then we're telling it to keep the thread open, right? To run a server and to block so that the JVM doesn't just quit immediately. Start and then stop. All right. Now let's see what that gives us if we just run that by itself, right? So run. Now when I compile this code and I run it, it's important to make sure that you select single instance only there in your IDE next time you use it, because otherwise it'll start the same application up again, and it'll there'll be a port conflict, so we want to avoid that. Okay, so run again. You can see nothing interesting is happening, but it is working, right? We have an application that's up and running now. Let's configure some things that we care about. First of all, I want to use MongoDB. So I'm going to say, configure MongoDB for me, please. Easiest way to do it is just to say it like that. Now, of course, you could specify a URL of the form MongoDB b localhost /test, right? And that's a hard-coded URL, which is not great. So we can use the Spring ENV, the environment abstraction, which is available through the ENV accessor there. And there's a Kotlin DSL that lets us index into different keys like you would index into an array. So I'm going to say Mongo URI. So that's the URL that I want to use. Or if it doesn't exist, I want to use MongoDB localhost test. All right. So there, I'm configuring MongoDB. I'm using the Elvis operator here. This is something that you would have done you would have had to get the property. You would say get property if you're using the API from Java, and you'd ask for the URL, and you check if it's null. And if it's null, then you return this string. Otherwise, you use whatever you got from this. Well, all that is just handled for you by using this little Elvis operator. And this is called the Elvis operator because, well, if you kind of turn your head to the side and look at the dash of hair and the eyes there, it kind of looks like Elvis. I don't know. Whatever. So we got that now. We want to configure the web support. Let's create a Webflex application using Spring Webflex, and we're going to create a server application that's going to use Netty for the runtime. And once we're inside of Netty, let's create a application that uses Mustache for server-side views, and we can configure things about Mustache, the prefix, the suffix, all that kind of stuff. We want to configure certain codecs. You know, how do we want to render our objects, right? When we create REST APIs, do we want to use JSON or XML or whatever? So let's just bring in support here for the JSON codec, right? So JSON, there we are, and we have some options there as well, right? And finally, let's create some routes. So this is a DSL that will then turn whatever we give it into a router, which is an API in Spring Framework itself. This is not, you know, the router stuff is not unique to Spring Foo by any stretch. So let's create the simplest thing that could possibly work. Hello. And we're just going to return OK.body. I'm using the Reactive Server Response API. This is the functional reactive endpoints from Spring Webflux. And this is in Spring Framework 5, right? The functional reactive endpoints are not new. They've been since Spring Framework 5 itself. And they're available in Java and Kotlin, but they're just really nice to use. That's the default approach here. So we're going to say, OK, build the body. And the body will contain a message. So we'll say val message equals flux.just hello world. All right. So there's this. I'm going to say message. All right. And I did that. I put those in two different lines so that we can get the compiler. We can get the tool, rather, IntelliJ, to be smart enough to understand that I'm not trying to use the body function on the server response object that's in there in the Java code. Instead, I'm trying to use the Kotlin extension function, which was added. You can see here's the source code for it. It's this extension function that gets added by Kotlin at runtime, or rather at compile time, so that from the perspective of my API, it looks like OK has this method or method incantation that supports just the payload. When in fact, if you look at the Java code for body, there is no such incantation. All of them take a second parameter that's of type class or a parameterized type reference. Basically, that's a super type token reference. We don't need that in our Kotlin code, though, because we can use inline reified functions. Okay, the result is that this just works. Now, let's restart. Okay, something happened. No Netty transport. That's an interesting one. What did I do wrong? if I did this wrong. No netty transport native epoll in Java library path. Build.gradle. Feel like this should be unresolved reference plugins. Yeah, that's just me trying to run this. Okay, so let's see class.forName. That's bizarre. Oh, it's actually up and running. I think it's just logging that we don't want. So we should configure the logging in a second here. Localhost 8080. Hello. All right, so there's our hello endpoint. And you can see that I just scared myself. I gave myself quite a scare looking at this terrifying error here, Javalang unsatisfied link error. So it's trying to load a native library here, and it's not visible inside the Java library path, which is a bad situation to be in, and frankly, it's completely irrelevant. I don't even know why I'm seeing this error in the first place. Thankfully, we can configure the logging, so let's do that here. We're going to say logging, and here I'm going to disable, I'm going to say that the default level is info, which is the log level dot info, log level dot info. Okay, like this. Let's see, logging will be log level info. There's this. Great. For Spring Framework, I'm going to say org Spring Framework will be debug, and I'll say that I want anything related to the default listable bean factory to be log level warn, right? Log level warn. All right, so there we go. And I can, you know, you can go even further. You can actually configure things like, specific configuration for logback, for example. So I can say I want to support debug output equals true, and I can say I want to have a console appender and so on. So I can do all sorts of interesting things to customize the output there to silence the things I don't care about. And there we go. So that's actually it, right? That's the output I got now. If I run it like that, if I start again, there we are. So we're up and running. We've got an application. And now this is not much of an interesting application. It's, you know, fairly plain. But this is an application, and you can do all the normal things you would do with Spring Web Flux. So name, and then we can say, we can give it a, remember this is a lambda. And so we can specifically spell out the fact that there's a parameter called request like this. But in Kotlin, if you have a lambda that takes a single parameter, you can omit the parameter name and use the implicit variable called it. So it will, I can just say, hello it dot path variable name. All right, so there I'm doing a couple things. First of all, I'm using it, which is an implicit for request or for the incoming request payload, the server request object, and then I can dereference the name path variable, which is this bit here. And I'm using string substitution here to replace the, what did I just run? Oh, build, of course. Okay, go. Get rid of that one. Goodbye. Hello, world. All right, so there's my updated endpoint. Now, this is a very simple example. Let's go ahead and add some persistence. Let's talk to a database. Okay, so let's do a little bit more here to talk to a database. We'll return this as well. So env. Mongo URI, well, MongoDB colon localhost /test. All right, so if you're using Cloud Foundry or some sort of cloud platform, then you will probably get the URL for your Mongo application from an environment variable, in which case you'd use the env to access it like that. So there's this. Now, let's go ahead and create some persistence. Let's manage some persistence. I'm going to create a repository to store data in the database. So I'll create a reservation object, data class reservation, like so. And this reservation class will have some information about the reservation. The ID will be like this, and the name of the reservation will be like that. There we are. So it's going to be a MongoDB document, a Spring Data MongoDB document. And we're going to use at ID to signal that that's a primary key. And now I want to build a persist this into the database. I'm going to create a simple repository using the reactive MongoDB template. Okay, so I'll create a reservation repository, and I'm going to inject here the reservation, the reactive Mongo template, which has been created for me by this Mongo module, right? So this is a module. It's important to see that. What we're doing here, when you see these different extension functions on the application DSL class, what we're doing is we're contributing different modules, and these modules are just bits of code that then have access to the application context that then register different objects. So you can create your own module if you like, fairly straightforwardly, right? So all we're doing here, if you see this, it says this is a lambda that has access to the Mongo module. It's basically we're saying give us a lambda that the compiler will treat as though it lives on the Mongo module type itself, which means that you can then access other fields in that type and so on. Give us a lambda that acts like it's on the Mongo module and that returns unit, return a Mongo module implementation as a result of that. So when you use MongoDB, it creates a Mongo module, and then this function then at some point this gets turned into an actual module that gets registered in the application context. Basically, the modules ultimately turn into an application listener, which then gets turned into, we're using it to do programmatic or functional bean registration. So the result is that, you're explicitly bringing in objects into the application object graph. And you can do the same thing. You can add custom extension functions to the application DSL API in the same way. So you can have another jar that once it's added to the class path, you can then import, and you can add a function like this, an application DSL function, and you can add custom configuration. So we're using the module for Mongo module, and that's over here, Spring Data MongoDB Mongo module. And that in turn, let's see if I can decompile it. It's a little hideous, but it does work. It's decompiled to Java, whereas we're actually using Kotlin behind the scenes. Let's see, behind the scenes, ultimately, we're saying Mongo client create blah, blah, blah. I suppose I can just point you to the Mongo module in the Git repository. github.com spring-projects spring-foo. And here, Mongo module. Mongo module looks like this. So at some point in the module, we're given a pointer to the application context, which of course is the root of Spring. It's where all the beans get wired up and live, and we're using that context reference to initialize the application. We're registering different beans, including conversions and the MongoDB clients and the connection factory and all that kind of stuff, and that gets done for you automatically. Okay, so you do need to know about it, but you don't need to know how it's done, right? And this is different from Spring Boot, where just by having the right types on the class path, it just works out of the box. And so here it's a little bit more explicit, but it's not like this isn't overwhelming, right? I had to do, where was it? I don't even know where I found it. It's so small. There, one thing, one line, right? I'm explicitly bringing in support for this API. Now, with that done, I want to create some data, right? I want to be able to manage data in the database. I'm going to use the reactive Mongo template. Here I've got a bean that I'm expecting to be configured and to have a pointer to this other object. And we'll come back to how that gets wired up in a second, but our repository is going to support useful things like deleting, right? Fun delete. And I'll say this dot reactive Mongo repository dot delete, or just drop collection. I'm going to tell it I want to drop everything of type reservation. Okay, so again, extension function. This is Spring Data MongoDB extension function. Fun save r reservation equals this dot reactive MongoDB dot save r fun, and then we want to do what? We want to do let's do find all. All right, this is I think another useful example. So reactive Mongo template dot find all. All right. And again, notice that we're not spending a lot of time passing in type tokens and all that. We have these nice extension functions that are available in the template. And as a result, we can figure out what type of data to return just by the generic parameter here. This generic parameter here is reified, sort of, right? And the result is that we can just use this. Now, I also want to write some sample data to the database, so we'll come back to that in a second, but let's register this repository and tell Spring about it. And so we're going to create a simple bean up here, and we can do it anywhere, really. I suppose down here is as good a place as any, so we'll say bean, and it's going to be of type reservation repository. And that's it. We could do a lot more here. We could give it a name, my Mongo reservation repository. That's certainly one option you could do. You could configure things like the scope, whether it's lazy, whether it's the primary instance, the auto wiring mode. I mean, all sorts of stuff. And there's the final parameter here. The final parameter that you get at the end there is supplier. It's just a lambda, right? The final operator option is this is a lambda, and you can use that to provide a instance of the bean. So here I can say reservation repository, and I'm going to look up a reference to the Reactive Mongo template. So RMT ref Reactive Mongo template, and I can push that in there, and there we go. So there's my custom bean name. I'm giving it a custom bean ID, and I'm giving it a custom reference that I've hand built. But I don't have to do that. Again, I could just say like this, and that would be the same result in this case. I would get a working repository both ways. So let's go ahead and run this code like so, and then we'll do it again without that. Let's go create a simple REST endpoint and some sample data and see what happens. So another REST endpoint, we're going to say API reservations. I'm going to say serve OK dot body, and we need a pointer to that reservation repository. So I'm going to say give us a reference to that bean. And I'll say reservation repository dot find all. All right, so that's it. That's my simple REST API. Let's see what that looks like. All right, now we have this application up and running. API reservations. There's some data in the database from a previous run. Let's go ahead and insert some sample data here. Okay, so we'll do the same thing as we did before. We'll create a new bean of type runner, class reservation application runner, and this will be a bean that implements the initializing bean contract. Initializing bean is the callback interface in Spring that's been there since Spring 1.0, and we're going to inject the pointer to our reservation repository there. We'll write some data. So we're going to say this dot reservation repository dot delete all, basically. So then we're going to say this dot reservation repository dot find all, or actually then many. We're going to say flux dot just a b c d dot map, taking each one of these and turning it into a reservation using the constructor here. So the property is going to be called name. That's where we're specifically addressing the property called name. We could address the ID as well, or we could pass them both just without addressing them, without naming them if we want to, without using name parameters, but I prefer to. So then we'll do that, and then once that's done, I'm going to save each record. So I'll say this dot reservation repository dot save, and then finally subscribe print line. Alrighty. Goody. So there's that. Oh, we don't want to subscribe here, do we? We want to subscribe after all that's done. There we are. Look at that. So we're going to delete everything first. Then we're going to write data to the database. Then we're going to get everything back. And then we're going to print it out here. So we want to register this bean and tell Spring to manage it for us as well. So bean. All right. Good. So you can see the output there on the console. Got names A, B, C, D, and there we are. If I refresh the endpoint, we get the updated information. Now, you see I've registered now two different beans, two different ways. I've registered the bean very explicitly here using the longer syntax. I'm actually explicitly wiring up the instance. This last parameter is a Java 8 supplier, right? So it's a supplier If you look at the contract, it's just a thing that produces another object. So a supplier here just has one method, tget, where t is the generic type that we want to supply. And here, I'm just telling it to create a bean using, you know, just figure it out. Look at the type, create an instance of it, supply whatever dependencies are required for the constructor, and then work. Now, this is very explicit. And notice I've got this initializing bean interface here. This interface is in Spring. It's been there since forever. And it is part of the guarantees of the Spring application context or the Spring framework. It will honor this lifecycle callback. Now, that isn't the only way to have Spring initialize your application. Certainly, you could use a constructor. That's another option. Or you could use a post-construct method. So let's suppose I called this init, and I decided to use the annotation. I could say fun at post-construct. All right, what happens if I do that? Well, I'm not going to like the result. I get a feeling. Look at that. Where's my data? Nothing happened. There's no data. Right? I got the same four records that I had before. But let's say I wanted to change this. Let's just add another record so we can see that the new that this function isn't being run, right? There's no E. And the reason is because Spring doesn't care about annotations at the moment. The way it's configured is that we're using a generic application context, not a annotation config application context. So when you call app.run, where's my app.run? Here, app.run. When you call app.run, it creates a generic application context which doesn't know about Java configuration. It doesn't know about anything, really. It's just a very simple container of beans. It knows about functional bean registration, but that's it, right? It knows about the application listeners, basically. So we need to if we want to be able to use some of our existing Java configuration and all that kind of stuff, then we need to override the application context that it works with. And so we can say annotation config application context, like that. And now what happens? There we are. And there's our E right there. So the benefit there is, you know, we have the ability to use Java configuration, which gets us to another very important point, which is, what if I had a Java configuration class? Maybe I have some old config laying around in Java configuration. And again, that's not going away. It's just not very functional, right? It's not very, I wouldn't write a new application using Java config and Spring Foo. I would use Spring Boot if I wanted to do more Java config style things. If I wanted to use blocking IO, I would use Spring Boot. I mean, there's a lot of reasons to not use Spring Foo, but if you want a functional sort of a explicit approach, then the Java configuration style isn't necessarily your first thing to reach out for. But if you do want to use Spring Foo, but you've got a lot of stuff tied up into Java configuration, and you want to make it work, it's possible, now that you understand this discrepancy, this hierarchy. So remember, Spring, the bean, you know, if you look at the hierarchy for application context, they are very, very deep, right? You've got annotation config application context extends this, which in turn extends that, which in turn extends this, which in turn extends that, which in turn extends, where does it go? Listable bean factory, which in turn extends bean factory, which in turn is the root object for all of Springdom, right? And all the use cases that you may have heard about, okay? Now, I'm going to create a config class. So let's not register. I'm going to register this bean using Java config. So I'll remove it from here just so we can do it from Java configuration. And my Java config, and this Java config is going to have to be open. Remember, we're now bringing in reflection and all that stuff. So we have to make sure that this is open because otherwise Spring can't proxy this class. Remember, by default, Kotlin makes things final. It seals the types that you have to explicitly open them. And if you're using Spring Boot, you don't have to worry about this because you have the all open plugin. And the same is true for methods. So I'm going to say I'm going to create a bean of type repository equals reservation repository, passing in a pointer to the reactive mongo template. There we are. So there's our Java configuration, and I want to use this now just as I did before anything else in my application. So here bean There we are. So now I'm using Java configuration. I'm telling Spring Foo about Java config by using the annotation config application context. And the result should hopefully be the same. All right, looks okay. Nothing broke, so that's interesting. So we got this. Good, so there's our application, same data, and so on, but we're using Java config. Again, I wouldn't do this unless you needed to. If you're going for Spring Foo and this is definitely something I would use for greenfield applications, right? This is not meant to be a place to run all your existing applications. But if you need it, it's there. I would avoid it because you lose some of the benefits of what we're trying to do here, which is to be able to predict ahead of time what types are on the class path and then to use that resulting insight to be able to then generate really fast booting images. And we're going to do that. So we have a lot of things on the roadmap here. Obviously, this is super, super, super new. So feedback is always appreciated here. We have a lot of things on the roadmap, some of which are illustrated very nicely here in the README on the front page of this Git project. We have a Spring package filtering. So basically, we can at compile time we can package the types that are not being used from different jars in the Spring application framework. We can package, we can filter, we can extract, or remove those types from the jars, and then package only the jars that you need, only the classes that you need in your application. We want to be able to support reactive or coroutine-based SQL support. So Kotlin has native support for coroutines, which is not something that you have in Java yet, or any other stack I typically talk about. So coroutines are a nice feature, and it means that you can write fundamentally blocking code and still have it turn into asynchronous code, right, behind the scenes, and that's really nice. We want actuators, of course, a lot of options, a lot of things that we want to be able to support beyond this this very, very preliminary version here. Oh, I didn't even get to show you a one last thing before we're done for the time. Let's create a view. So let's say git view, or just even better yet, reservations.html. All right, so server response dot ok dot render reservations, and I'm going to create a model, a map of reservations to reservation repository dot find all. Okay, so there's I'm rendering a view now instead of sending a JSON document back, and now in the resources directory, I'll create a directory source main resources templates, and inside of there I'll create a reservations.mustache, which is the templating library that I have in the class path here. Okay, so with that, put that in there. With that, I'll say, okay, for every element in the reservations model attribute that we just created, I'm going to show the data, okay? So like that, and then I'm going to create a line item for each one, and it'll be reservation with the ID, and what else do we want? We want the name itself. All right, good. Oops, too many curly brackets there. Good, and that should be enough. Let's try running that. Okay, reservations.html, haha, voilà. All right, so with that, we've looked at Spring Foo, which is a brand new project that is very highly opinionated. It's optimized for reactive, explicit programming with Spring. It takes advantage of different aspects of the Spring ecosystem. It is super early days yet. This was a dark project, a stealth project that we had been working on in the background up until last week, like in the last 5 days. When we announced it, the first tweet got over 500 likes in the first few days. It was very, 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 very warm response from the community. We're hoping that people will give it a go and try it out. We have an application right now. You can see I've got a REST application that's talking to the database. The whole thing, including that little tangent there, that little digression, to demonstrate Java config and all this kind of stuff. That whole thing is, what, 87 lines of code? I mean, it's Very, very trivial. Obviously, in a production application, there's no reason that this stuff couldn't live. Like, for example, the routes could be a function that lives in another code page that then you import. You can actually say routes import, and you could give it a lambda. So import equals, and then you can give it a function reference or just inline the lambda right there if you want. But the point is, this stuff could live in different code pages. I've just got it all in one code page because that's how I like to write these short, simple demos. And it really drives home the point that this is, you know, as small as you want it to be. It doesn't get more explicit than this. We have now a resulting application, an application that we can deploy to a cloud. So if we go to reservation service here, Gradle shadow jar, and the second time, by the way, that I run that, it's, you know, 1 second, right? So it gets very quick for both running and for compiling once you've run it and compiled it once. Okay, now let's see. Find minus all dot jar using an asterisk there. That's the built jar, Java minus jar. There's the application up and running. All right, so there we are. There's the data as before. So we have a very, very quick micro framework, very, very nice approach to building applications using Kotlin, which is now what with Google's recent endorsement, not just support, but now endorsement as of the latest Google I/O, they endorse Kotlin as a choice for, as a target platform, as a target language for the Android platform. With that support, we're seeing an increasing number of developers using Kotlin. It's fast on track to be the number two language in the JVM. And you can see that there's a really rich history. I mean, Google's supporting it, right? There's support from JetBrains, the company that makes it. You can use it for native code. You can use it for the front end. You can use it for the back end. When we've seen in previous installments, I've done at least two different Spring tips on different aspects of Kotlin and Spring. There's a good support for using it in the back end as well. But this new option, this Spring Foo, this marks a new adventure, a new option for developers building Kotlin-based code on the JVM. And we hope you'll give it a go. So with that, be sure to check out the sample repository for this. This is a sample that's in spring-tips on GitHub. So github.com/spring-tips. You'll find this sample, right, which is standalone. So after you've installed the Spring Foo project, if you can't get the dependencies from the snapshot libraries, just check out this example after you've installed it. And, you know, from there, feedback. With that, my friends, thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.